We're just a touch away. Monday to Friday at 12:30 p.m. Only on Bloomberg Quint.
Bloomberg Quint, you're watching The Fine Print. There wasn't a dull moment for the Supreme Court of India in 2018. It started out with the unprecedented media briefing by four senior Supreme Court judges. Then, an impeachment motion against former CJI Justice Deepak Mishra. Rumblings and allegations of foul play in Judge Loya's case that were met with a quick dismissal. And now, the infighting within the CBI that the apex court must sort out. But it wasn't just about controversy. The apex court's progressive stance in striking down Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code was applauded by most. And curiously, its verdict in the Aadhaar matter was claimed as a victory by both sides. It wasn't just the constitutional issues that kept the apex court busy. Insolvency cases with far-reaching commercial implications saw a speedy disposal as well. At the centre of a lot of this was former Attorney General and senior Supreme Court advocate Mukul Rohatgi, who's joining us now to give us his insights on some of these landmark cases. Mr. Rohatgi, thank you for joining us here on The Fine Print. What would you remember 2018 for in the context of what happened in the Supreme Court?
Well, as a year of very historic verdicts, thanks principally to the Chief Justice, who worked very hard and had several five-judge benches. We have never seen so many five-judge benches delivering judgments one after the other. And secondly, as you mentioned, the unprecedented press interview by four judges. I think these were the highlights of this year. And all I can say is that I was a part of some of them. For example, I led the arguments in the 377 case. And as far as the press conference is concerned, generally there have been two views, some supporting the press conference, some opposing the conference. And I know you're going to ask me, so I might as well tell you.
Yes, before you get there, what was your first reaction, sir, when you first heard that the four judges of the Supreme Court...
I was stunned.
Okay.
Because it's completely out of the ordinary. You have press conferences by all kinds of people, whether it's politicians or bureaucrats. But I've never heard of press conferences by judges, and that too of the highest court. I, for one, having been a part of this community for 40 years now, I, for one, do not subscribe to this press conference. It's something like unionism within a court. It's a sure way that it will affect the foundation of the court. The court has to be uniform, unanimous, cohesive, and together.
But some say, sir, that sunshine is the best disinfectant.
Look.
And by doing what they did, these four judges have brought to forth conversations that weren't getting, like you said, sorted out within the four walls of the Supreme Court and thus merited a conversation outside of it.
I don't think that proper attempts were made to sort it out within the court. See, there are 26 to 30 judges. It was possible for these four senior most judges to call for a meeting of all the judges together. Even if the Chief Justice was not calling, nobody stopped these four judges of calling all the judges together, and I'm sure they would have come because they're all junior to these first four or five. They could have called for an informal meet at some of these judges' houses, discussed it, and then maybe some consensus would have been reached between 15, 20, 25 judges together. And in that consensus, they would have all gone to the Chief Justice and said, well, this is what is wrong. So this outburst by four in a group of 25 or 30, according to me, is not warranted. See, people look up to the Supreme Court. It's the last frontier, so to say. people go to the court. Supreme Court is the last court. If people find that the Supreme Court is also shaking and people are talking in discordant voices in the court itself, it also affects the image which people have in their minds of that court, and they say, oh, even this institution is going, you know, hither and thither.
But I'm so that's sure, also sir, very all important. Along these discordant voices have persisted, but it's just that people like us haven't, you know, gotten to know about them.
No.
Probably this is the first time that the public got to hear
of it. It has never been so discordant,
it.
Madam. I have been here for 40 years.
Okay.
Things have happened. There have been errant judges. Some judges don't behave properly. All that has happened. But it's never been to this extent. But I think it's behind us. We should forget it.
Okay.
We
so
should look forward.
One of the sort of issues raised by these four senior judges was the allocation of cases to benches. That they said was done in an arbitrary fashion, post which a roster system was put in place. Is that roster system the answer?
No, madam, let me tell you. Please understand. Let me explain this to you. Normally, a roster system is that this bench will do, say, four types of cases: criminal cases, arbitration cases, industrial law cases, or service disputes. Another bench will have a roster of, say, civil cases, company law disputes, constitutional disputes, like that. So it's not one individual line that you only do criminal. That happens in the high courts, in the Supreme Court. It's broadened. So you get four types of cases. Another bench will get five types of cases. The complaint of these judges was not the roster system.
It was the allocation of cases to the benches.
Yes, which was that these judges felt that certain important cases in their view were going to junior judges, which
correct.
Involved high political figures, were going to bench number 9, bench number 10, bench number 11.
So how do we solve that problem?
Yeah, so now look, it has always been known that the Chief Justice is the master of the roster. Okay, whichever way the Chief Justice divides cases, there can always be protests. Always be. Why did you give this to him, this to him? It has never happened. A judge is supposed to do cases which come his way. And it's not as if there are few cases.
But what if there is a pattern of important cases going to certain courts or certain benches?
Madam, whatever it is, Chief Justice is the master. He decides. And according to me, every judge should do what is on his plate.
No.
And it's not as if you don't have less on your plate. I can understand if you have less and you are sitting and another judge is doing so many cases, you say, oh, well, I'm just...
I don't think so. I guess the benches would complain of less work. What
yeah.
I'm trying to get to is then
yeah.
that this situation, that Chief Justice is the master of the roster, has persisted for last several decades now,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes.
But there seems to be a problem with this method. How do we repair that situation?
I don't think, madam, there is any problem. It is just being oversensitive. Now, let me tell you, in the last 40, 30 years that I have seen, judges form benches with seniority. So the Chief Justice forms bench number 1. The second senior most judge will be head of bench number 2. The third senior most judge will be bench number 3. Suppose the second senior most judge is not placed in a bench of 2 judges, right? But is placed as a single judge, right? Which can be. The second judge in the current scenario in the last 40 years will take affront. I was a senior judge. I sit in appeals. I hear appeals against single judges. Why have been made a single judge myself? And my appeal will go to 2 junior judges. This is what, you know, this so-called seniority business has come to. Let me tell you, 50 years ago, the Chief Justice of the Bombay High Court was M.C. Chagla, one of the most celebrated judges this country has produced. He refused to come to the Supreme Court. That's a different matter. But he used to sit as a single judge, as the Chief Justice. And an appeal would lie from his judgment to 2 junior judges. It was never thought as an affront and stuff like that. It's all new things which are happening here.
Which is fine, sir.
Yeah.
Which is why I'm saying, since times are changing, and clearly this incident has brought to light that this method or this function is not foolproof, is there an alternate?
Madam, if you have individuals, there will always be subjectivity. There can never be any foolproof system that way. You know, otherwise, you leave
can
every...
Can you try something new?
Well, I'm sure the new Chief Justice now, who is a part of those 4 judges, he may have addressed this system, I don't know. But there is nothing clearly available
Do you have any inkling of how he could potentially address this or any insight?
I have no idea. There is nothing in public domain. See, one simple way is you should then, one way is to say the Chief Justice has no discretion. He is not a master of the roster. He is just one amongst the equals. The computer does everything. So 30 cases come. One will go to court one, second will go to court two, third will go to court three, and the 20th case will go to court number 20 or whatever. And then again, 1 to 20, 1 to 20, 1 to 20. So it goes lying like a water mill. That's one simple way of doing it.
Right? Sure, okay.
But you must know, the Supreme Court has had a tradition, which I have seen for many years, that important cases, cases of national importance, cases which are politically sensitive, which are in the newspapers, people say surkhiyon mein hai, those cases are never generally marked by the computer. They are taken to the Chief Justice by the registry. And the Chief Justice will look at the sensitivity of the case and then decide where is it going to be. He may not send it to court number 9 or 10, which was the grievance here. He may send it to the first 5. But there again, some amount of subjectivity is there. And mostly, the sensitive cases are placed in the first court itself.
Okay, all right. Let's come to the other important headline of this year, which is the verdict in Judge Loya's case. You argued the matter on behalf of the state of Maharashtra, and it was the state of Maharashtra's discrete inquiry report that the Supreme Court largely relied upon in dismissing the allegations or the rumblings that there was some foul play.
Yeah.
One of the criticisms of this judgment was, sir, that the apex court had failed to protect the subordinate judiciary by refusing to even entertain the idea of an independent inquiry. What do you have to say to
Madam,
this view?
According to me, it was just sensationalizing the death of a judge by questionable means and by a group of persons who were not really interested in any inquiry, who were only interested in bringing heat upon a political functionary, namely Mr. Amit Shah, who was discharged by a judge, etc., in Bombay. So that was the object. The object was not that Mr. Loya died a mysterious death. That became, you know, the cover, the subterfuge. That was clear in this whole situation. But let me tell you, there were two important aspects to this case which could not be denied and because of which no inquiry apart from the current one was necessary, and that is this. There were three district judges who were with Mr. Loya for full 24 hours when they travelled from Bombay to Nagpur for a wedding, stayed in the Nag bungalow, and they were together, and that judge literally died in the lap of these three judges. These three judges took him to hospital, took him to the second hospital which had better care, and he passed away right there. It happened in front of those doctors, it happened in front of these three judges, and three or four judges of the Bombay High Court happened to be in Nagpur. They came to the hospital at 7 a.m. and this happened at about 6 a.m. So everybody was together.
Sure, yeah.
It was all as simple as that.
All of that
So then why should you have another inquiry just to sensationalize things?
Sir, there is an age-old saying that, you know, justice must not only be done but also seen to be done.
Well, in this case, I think it was seen to be done completely.
What was the downside of ordering an independent investigation?
Sensationalizing, making those three, that means you don't believe what those three judges said?
But they weren't under oath.
Madam,
but
you,
are you saying that?
So you think they will tell lies?
No.
All three of them?
But then come under oath. Come on oath.
Judges,
but are you not setting a precedent that when judges
Madam,
are making
inquiries are not ordered at the drop of a hat. You must see the three district judges and four high court judges. So you should bring all of them under oath. I mean, it is an absurd idea.
But
unless there is some gross discrepancy. Suppose one judge had said, let me give you an example. There were three together. Suppose one judge had said, I wasn't with them. And they are falsely accusing me by saying that we were together. I wasn't here. Or the judge never died in front of me. I can understand. Some great discordant things. You don't order it like the drop of a hat. The entire judiciary comes under this kind of a synosure, and they become witnesses for what?
Okay, sir, I probably don't understand criminal law as much as you do, but I can only hypothesize. Let's say there is another matter, okay, and you bring a letter by a judge who was witness to that crime. Should now, based on this precedent, we should take judges in and their letters in their personal capacity, where they're not under oath, where there's no cross-examination? No,
madam, you are generalizing the issue. If a judge...
I'm not. I'm just trying to assess the precedent.
Let me tell you. If a judge is a witness to a murder, let us say, right? And if he's summoned as a witness, he will be. It's a murder with which he's not concerned. He happens to be a witness. He's seen it. He'll come and depose. It happens every day. No problem.
But now you're saying that let him make a statement outside of the court.
Yes.
And we can rely upon that. Is that kosher?
What I'm saying is the example you are giving, or which I am giving, of a murder is completely different from the situation which happened. That man died in front of them. There was a post-mortem. Everything was done. What is the need for an inquiry just because you say or somebody says you shouldn't?
No, sir. I have no stake in it. I'm just trying to understand.
Else.
No. I'm just trying to understand.
I told you, madam, there was a collateral purpose to it. It was a collateral purpose. This inquiry issue commenced many months after he died.
But okay, so those who firmly believe that there was a collateral purpose shouldn't have anything to worry about if an independent investigation...
It is destroying the institution that if you give in to these kind of people who have questionable motives, you are destroying an institution. That judge should now come in evidence this. And one of the allegations made by these people in the court was against the entire administrative committee of the Bombay High Court, which consists of 5 senior most judges. Why did they transfer somebody? Why not transfer somebody? And one of those petitions filed a contempt petition against 5 judges of the Bombay High Court.
No.
You know, there were so many things which showed that it was a telltale. It was a telltale matter only to scandalize and look at their ultimate object. It had nothing to do, really speaking, with the death of the poor judge.
All I'm saying, sir, that if those who firmly believed in the truth, that there was no foul play in the death of Judge Loya, would have been vindicated.
I told you, madam, the result would be scandalizing the judiciary.
Okay, all right.
All kinds of questions would be asked to those judges. I mean, if I get a chance and I want to scandalize, I would tell the High Court judge, the Chief Justice was there. They say, you were never there, or you were mixed up, or you are a pawn of Mr. Shah, or you are a pawn of this. All this would be blown up by the press. This is the problem.
But, sir, there were lapses in the reports, in the...
Madam, there was no lapse in the report at all.
Okay, all right. You look like that.
No, I remember it. It went on for some 20 hearings. A case which would have ended in 4 hearings went on for 20 half days.
Okay, all right. Let me come to another, important case of this year, which was the Aadhaar verdict. How do you think this will play out for private entities since Section 57 has been struck down? Some are reading the language of the order to mean that the commercial exploitation of Aadhaar has been struck down by the Supreme Court. Do you believe that the government can come out with legislation that will allow private use of Aadhaar?
The government can certainly bring a legislation. It's a well-known tool to overturn a judgment of the court. You can do that. But I personally believe the judgment of Justice Sikri is a very balanced judgment. He has upheld the majority of the laudable objects of Aadhaar, but he has stopped the creeping expansions, and I think it is correct. I don't want to trust my confidential details or my details, because I also have a right of privacy, which has now been held in the judgment, that it should be given to somebody who may not be responsible, and then it kind of goes around. So I think it's a good judgment, and I don't think the government will take it as an affront. That's not so.
But do you see that as a setback for the government, given the kind of ambitions they had?
Not really, madam. Actually, as I told you, it was really meant for a laudable object, that people should get their subsidies and all that. From there, we went to, the poor people should be able to get a bank account. All that has happened. So this was maybe too optimistic in going further. They have gone pretty much. But they've been stopped at the right level, according to me. I think it's fine.
This year, there was also the judgment in the Sabarimala verdict, where the rights of women of a certain age bracket have been upheld to enter the temple. Last year, we saw the Supreme Court strike down the concept of triple talaq. Do you believe
I was the
that
lawyer in triple talaq for the government.
Yes. Do you believe, sir, that Supreme Court taking up cases or looking at rights in the context of what a religion allows, is that a slippery slope?
It's very slippery, madam, according to me. Insofar as triple talaq is concerned, I think it was rightly taken. Because the impact of triple talaq and that practice is disastrous upon a huge amount of women belonging to a particular religion. Right from birth or from the time that they can understand, maybe 7 or 10 years of age, it is drilled into them and through the circumstances that if they don't go along with the husband or the male, you may be standing on the road tomorrow. And this huge amount of destitutes, problems, exploitation has occurred. Therefore, Supreme Court did the right thing. But when it comes to Sabarimala, the position is different.
How is that?
I'll tell you. Sabarimala doesn't have issues of disastrous situations of life and death, which is available, which happens in triple talaq. Sabarimala is a matter of religion. Legally, the court, 4 judges to 1, have placed the right of equality over the religious practice. So legally, according to me, the judgment of the 4 judges is flawed. Why I say so, if somebody may agree, may not agree, I feel the lady judge was right. Because in a matter of a religious practice, you don't have the problems of triple talaq. And religious practice does not always follow logic or reason. Right? And it is not as if that it is important that every woman in that area must go only to that temple to worship. It can't be made the point that I must enter the temple.
But equally, you can't tell me that where I must go and where I shouldn't.
No. So I'm going a little further. So now take a case. Even in the Western world, you can't have a woman as a pope or as the Archbishop of Canterbury. It's not there. It's been going on.
Must we take inspiration from
No, I'm not an inspiration. I didn't mean inspiration at all. I meant there are some things which have gone on in that way, which is not really anything to do with equality. It's nothing to do with equality.
Why not?
It's just happened that for thousands of years.
Yeah, they use the word patriarchy in the 4 judges, use the word patriarchy in the judgment.
I don't want to say patriarchy. You know, legally you are putting equality and the right of religion one over the other. Both exist in the same chapter of the Constitution. Article 14 and Article 25. Both are equal. Not one is above the other. So you have to marry both. You can't marry both unless, you know, you say they are equal. If they are equal, you may have a right of equality, but I have a right of religion. And that religion includes the religious practice. A religious practice includes how you go, you maybe shave your head or this, that or the other. So it's a tricky subject. Now it's been placed in January.
Right.
Before Chief Justice was kind enough to put it for open court hearing.
Right.
And I think the debate needs to go on a little further.
Okay. All right. So I'd like to end with a little bit of your personal journey before I let you go. You've been a government officer twice in your career, one during the Vajpayee government tenure and then as an attorney general during the Modi government. Was there any change for you as a law officer between two regimes?
Not really, madam. I don't think there is much difference in the job of a lawyer, whether attorney general or whether an ASG or even with any other lawyer. Because, you know, the governments really don't interfere much. You know, you carry on as a government lawyer, you deal with bureaucrats, you deal with regular files. It's only at some stages, some stray cases, which become important and are important that way. But I really didn't find any real difference when I was working in the Vajpayee government or working with the Modi government. Not really.
Okay, all right. What has been the most challenging case of your career?
One case I remember, I appeared for the state of Haryana in the Supreme Court, defending a law which said that unless a municipal law of the state of Haryana, which said that unless you have passed 8th standard, unless you have a toilet in your house, unless you have no dues against banks, you will not be allowed to cast a vote. And this was important because, you know, our democracy is based not on the fact how much you have studied. Every illiterate person on the road has an equal vote like me or you, whether he's rich, whether he's poor, whether he lives on the road, whether he has a house, whether he doesn't have a house. So for the first time under the Modi initiative, you should have a toilet, you should have this, you should have that. This law was passed. And it was hard, the bench was hard upon me. How do you merge it or marry it with, let's say, a Lok Sabha election? If you don't have these in a Lok Sabha election, even the minister need not, have studied up to the fourth class. How can you expect it in a panchayat?
Right.
That was probably one of the difficult cases, but I got through.
All right, I'll let that be the last word, sir. Thank you very much for joining me on the Fine Print, and thank you so much for watching.